सभी को नमस्कार, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। आज का हमारा ये सत्र जो है, हमारी भारतीय कला और विरासत को हम समझते हुए, हम इस संस्कृतियों को, अलग अलग राज्यों की जो संस्कृति है, कल्चर जो है, उसे समझने के लिए हम उस राज्य के संग्रहालयों की तरफ देखें। जैसा कि हमने हमारे लास्ट सेशन में बताया था कि किसी भी राज्य के संग्रहालय जो होते हैं, वो वहाँ की कला, स्थापत्य और संस्कृति की जानकारी हमें ठीक से बताते हैं। तो ऐसे ही एक राज्य जो सारे विश्व भर में मशहूर है, ऐसे एक राज्य की जानकारी आज हम यहाँ पर लेंगे। हमारे आज के सेशन की जो यहाँ व्याख्याता है, अंजलि जी, अंजलि मापारी जी यहाँ उपस्थित है, मैं उनका भी यहाँ स्वागत करता हूँ। और आज जी जी थैंक यू थैंक यू। और हमारे आज के सत्र की हम यहाँ शुरुआत करते हैं। जस्ट अ मिनट। Can you see it now? क्या आपको दिखाई दे रहा है?
Yes,
please, please start it now. Now I will stop my audio and video from this side. You will continue, please.
Very good morning to all of you all, and I would like to thank the Deccan Archaeological and Cultural Research Institute and Heritage Foundation Jalgaon for giving me this opportunity to present my presentation on the museums of Goa for museum heritage in India. So, as sir rightly said, any region's museum is the potential source where you can see the entire region's cultural, social, economic, all kind of influence of its past, of its the artifacts. And artifacts are the only medium where you can literally connect with the what arguments have been made. So to begin with, I would like to start. So can we? Yes, we are on the right slide. So to begin with, I would like to go a bit back. Where did the museum foundation of in Indian history was laid? Okay, so the seeds of museum was sown in the ancient time in prehistoric cave paintings, Alekhya Grihas, Chitrashalas, Devakulas, Vishwakarma Mandirs and monasteries that served the purpose of education and entertainment. The genesis of present-day museum that we see, that they go back to the foundation of the Asiatic Society of Bengal in 1784. And that was the first time the Asiatic Society of Bengal, by a historical decision made in 1796, to open up its collection to the public by establishing the Indian Museum Kolkata in 1814 under the curatorship of Dr. Nathaniel Wallace. So this was the first museum that we have in India. So while we come in the Goan context, so we have to understand the thing that by the time India was free, Goa was still under the Portuguese rule, and all this, and we have lost lot of things in that Inquisition period or the conversion period. So the mention of Chitrashalas or this traditional sort of museums, we do not find their mention in Goan context. Okay, so the references to Chitrashalas in ancient Indian literature, which stands for galleries, housing paintings, sculptures, and other works of art, are not found in terms of Goa. But the Chitrashalas or collection were not open to public. So maybe there were collectors who did collect, and they were not open for public. So Goa was ruled by many dynasties such as Bhojas, Konkan Mauryas, Badami of Chalukyas, Shilahara, Kadamba, Vijayanagar, Bahamani's Adil Shah of Bijapur, followed by the colonial rule since 1510. And it was during the colonial rule, the museum activity that we see in modern sense was seen in Goan context. So can we go to the next slide? So in 1894, a committee was established under the chairmanship of Justice Antonio Braganza. This committee started collecting the objects of historical importance in one of the churches of Old Goa. So this awareness gave a weight up to three museums, or we can call them art galleries. So they were like Viceroy Gallery at Adil Shah Palace, the old secretariat that we know it as today. So today there, the Goa State Museum collection has been housed due to their renovation work. And then we have a gallery at Archbishop's Palace and one at the Institute Menezes Braganza, formerly known as the Institute Vasco da Gama. So these activities of collection during the pre-liberation period created a ground for formation of a committee in 1966. And on the basis of recommendation, steps were taken to form the museum of the area. So the initiative was started by Directorate of Archives and the Unit of Archaeology, and museums were set up in Goa. So that was the first museum of Goa, the Goa State Museum. Then they, so to like broadly divide or categorize the museums that I'll be talking today. So I have categorized them in government and non-government museums. So under non-government, there are private collectors as well. So under government, we have Goa State Museum, Archaeological Museum of Goa, Indian Customs and Central Excise Museum, and Indian Naval Aviation Museum. So under non-government museum, we have Pilar Seminary Museum. It is run by the Pilar Church and their missionary. So then we have Museum of Christian Art at Old Goa. Then we have Goa Chitra Museum. It's a private collection of Victor Gomes. Then we have Museum of Goa. Then we have Houses of Goa Museum. It's in North Goa. Then we have Moda Goa Museum in Kinarane village by in Bardo Taluka. It is by the late fashion designer Wendell Roderick. And then we have St. Thomas Museum. So can you see? So to start with, we will start with the first museum, the form the of the modern sense, that is the Goa State Museum. So Goa State Museum, this the building that you see in the left corner, it's the old building of the Goa State Museum, but now right now they are undergoing the renovation work. So the Goa State Museum was set up in 29 September 1977, primarily as a center of collecting objects of cultural and historical importance of Goa. Later in 1996, so I can't see the price presentation.
Yes, any problem?
Yeah, I cannot see the presentation.
But just it's there. It's okay. There, just yeah, there.
Yes.
Okay.
So then Goa State Museum, it was later in 1996, the collection was shifted to the Goa, to the museum building near Central Library, Pato, inaugurated by Shankar Dayal Sharma on 18 June. So 18 June is in Goa, it is celebrated as the Kranti Din, since the Ram Manohar Lohia had addressed open speech at the to the public, because expression of speech was banned in Goa that time. So 18 June is considered as the Kranti Din in Goa. Then the museum was started with the 13 galleries with acquisition of 1,000 objects. Can you go to the next slide, sir? Now we are talking about the collection of the museum. So here broadly I'll be talking about the entire collection of the museum that was housed in the old building as well. But today, due to the lack of space, they only have 4 galleries. So I'll be, for now, we will see the entire collection for now. The museum had earlier had 14 galleries, since they now shifted to the old secretariat, then Adil Shah Palace. they have exhibited only four galleries. So the sculpture gallery. So the sculptures collection of the museum majorly reflects Hindu form of worship that can be categorized into Shaivite, Vaishnavite, and Shaktivite. Museum possesses remarkable and rare figurines of Bhikshatan Murti of Bhairav, Chaturmukhi found in various parts of Goa, Vishnu sculptures, Mahishasur Mardini in varying style is popular deity of Goa, is there in the collection, and so is the panels of Gajalakshmi. The oldest sculpture is that of Simhaja dating back to 5th to 6th century. Fossil bone collected from Chandor by late V.R. Mitra Gotri, Assistant Superintendent Archaeologist, and Mr. M.R. Knight. It is also part of the collection. Apart from this, Goa has witnessed Jain and Buddhist tradition, and evidence of it we have sculptures belonging to this sect. Later we shall see the images as well. So there are also Sati stone and beardgirls in the collection. So next please. So the Christian art dominantly shows influence of Portuguese culture in Goa. A major attraction of this gallery is huge red flag marking the victory of Portuguese against Dutch in 1688 at Marmara Fort. Apart from this, local sculptures museum also houses generous donation made by Sri S.K. Banerjee, former Lieutenant Governor of Goa. This collection shows great diversity and variety of sculptures produced from stone, bronze, gilt bronze, wood coming from different parts of India and Southeast Asia. So then we will move on to their star objects or the highlights of their collection. So that is the one is the rug from the Chandrasekhar Bhutnath Temple at Paroda and the Inquisition Table. So this is what I felt to be like the star objects of the collection. For now, both the objects are not on display in the museum, basically with the lack of space. So the Inquisition Table's major attraction is a four leg in the shape of eagle killing snake and a lion wearing a crown. So this symbolizes the colonial view. So next slide, please. So currently there are four galleries in the museum. One is the Goan culture, then Goan expression through the ages, Portuguese phase and the freedom struggle. So in the Goan expression through the ages, Goan culture, it displays Goan culture before the Portuguese first come to India. Not India, Goa basically. So support of carved wooden pillar. It is made of jackfruit tree. So the pillar was acquisitioned from the Vithoba temple. So what does it say? The jackfruit tree is very local to the area, and the maximum use of like local or locally available material could be seen here. Then we have Padmanabh of Kadamba period. So a Vishnu sculpture, so where Dashavatar is carved on the back panel or Prabhavai of the sculpture, and every avatar, when it is shown on the panel, it has a Padma or the Kamal. Possession objects or transport objects such as Palki, Lalki, and Chariot. So these are the like temple procession vehicles that are used for the Palki of the procession of the deity. So then we have Vishnu Kumbhakar sculptures showcased in the Goan lifestyle. Sculptures, petroglyphic representation of Goan folk dances and Halo and Shivna. So why Vishnu Kumbhakar sculptures? So he has been in 1930s, he was the most known artist of Goan society, and the very specialty of his of the sculptures he used to make out of mud was that they were very lively. We could see one of the images in the later presentation. Then we have photographic representation of Bhalo Shivna. So these are the very intangible heritage part of Goa. So Dhalo is basically women oriented folk festival and Shigmo is male oriented festival. So during Dhalo, it's celebrated in the after somewhere after the harvest, that's after December into Jan to Feb. It varies from village to village how they celebrate the festival. So basically, women of the village come together, they dance, they perform Dhalo, they perform Kudi, they perform all sorts of folk dancing. So it's like kind of relaxation part for the women folk. Then we have Shigmo. Shigmo is celebrated towards the Holi celebration, where all the males come together, then dhol, tashe, these are the major instruments that are used during Shigmo. Then we are moving on to gallery 2. So chronologically, it starts with photographs of the petroglyphs of Panchalimal Udgalimal. So it's the area in Kete Taluka of Goa. So which are dated back to 800 BC according to P.P. Shirodkar. The gallery takes from inscription of Devaraja Bhoja of 4th century, Konkan Maurya of 7th century, Kadamba. The one inscription which is popularly known as the Kudi inscription of 10th century. Then we have copper plate. Then we have Vijayanagara inscription of 14th century. Then Chhatrapati Sambhaji inscription of 1668 AD. So this is the outline that I try to draw to cover the coverage of the inscriptions that we have in the museum. Next slide. So another important attraction of this gallery is the Gopinath sculpture near the Budbudkai or the bubbling lake from Mitravai village. So they the temple lake or kund that you could say, it has there are bubbles that come out of the water, and that's the main attraction of the temple. And the murti or the idol is of Gopinath. Gopinath is Vishnu's avatar. So basically, but the major festival of the temple is Mahashivratri. So we can see the diversity here. Then we have Buddha sculpture from the Rivona cave, near Rivona cave, Chovisi of Rishabhnan. Another remarkable sculpture here is Brahma sculpture from the Kom village in Sangha Taluka of Goa. So till now we are known that the Brahma temple is only in Pushkar. But no, we all in Goa we have a temple, Brahma temple in Brahma Karmali village of Satyari, which was shifted from Kiswadi village, not Kiswadi, Salset, sorry. So that was the shift that was done. So that is the existing Brahma temple we have in Goa for now. But this sculpture that was found in the Kom village of Sangha Taluka also marks that there could have been a temple that time. So we have the Brahma sculpture. So then we have Mahishasura Madini sculpture, important because various forms of goddess worship across Goa. And after this, Gajalakshmi sculptures found prominently across Goa. Gajalakshmi is considered as the prosperity symbol. Pueshwar form of Kartikeya, Ravana, Chaturmukhi, Shiva, Veerabhadra are important sculptures of the Sayagi. Sati sculptures found across Pernay to Salset Talukas of Goa, Sati stone and Vibhav. So this is the outline of the objects that are found in the museum gallery. So gallery 3 deals with the objects of Portuguese period. So St. Catherine's culture here is important from the point of view that when Portuguese were captured Goa, they first had built the church of St. Catherine. And as part of the mar or respect towards her, they built that church in Goa, at Old Goa. So another remarkable object of this gallery is the red flag. It's a huge flag as mark of the victory of Portuguese against Dutch in 1668 at Murgaon Fort. for furniture of this period, we could see prominently ivory has been used. And then we have press machine that is displayed. So in 1860, the press machine was brought in Goa, marking the entry of press in Goa in 1556, first in the entire Asia. Then Mircea Corbea de Goa, it's a chair. Okay, so the important chair is important here because it was a charity. The person who does charity would hold that chair. But that charity was limited only to the converted population and not the rest of the population. Next slide, please. So here on the left hand side, could you see the flag? So that is the flag, the red color flag that we were talking about. That was the mark of Portuguese victory against Dutch. So then we have on the right and top side, we have the women jumping in fire. So that is a Sati stone. And till my motif of the objects, I have seen this object for the first time. Like, I never, always when we see Sati stones, it's basically one hand and then we have sun and the moon on the other side. But a woman jumping in the fire, this is the only object I have seen. So then we have Chaturmukhi. So for Chaturmukhi Shiva, we could see the Jatamukut and the four-headed Shiva. And then on the extreme right that you see, it's a musical instrument, very local to Goan society. It is called as Ghumar. So the base part is made out of mud and the top covering is of the wild lizard skin. So next slide, please. So then we see this is the Inquisition table that we can see. So can you see the lion and the eagle? So they are the mark of the colonial power in Goa. So the last gallery that we can see is the Struggle Freedom Gallery. So in this, they have like represented the Goan freedom struggle in photographic representation, right from the Dipaji Rani revolt, the local protest, to Ram Manohar Lohia's speech on 18 June, and the contribution of Indian Army towards the Goan freedom struggle, their entry into Goa through the borders of Goa during the Goa liberation, and the first hoisting of the tricolor flag, then documents of surrender, then they also have the last signing of the surrender of Goa to India. So we have all this documentation in photographic form. Okay, so this is on the left hand side that you can see is the chitra, is the rat that we have talked about initially. So it is the rat from the Chandrishwar temple of Bhutnath, and Chandrishwar is the Aradhya Devat of Bhoja dynasty of Goa. Then on the right hand side, we can see the Vishnu Kumbhakar sculptures. If you can just observe, we could see the sculpture is made of mud. And during that period in 1930s, he has been like basically very intricate about the finishing of the sculpture. So then you can see on the left hand side is the Chovisi of Rishabhnath, and then on the right hand side we have Buddha. So this object was found, the Buddha image was found at the Rivona cave. Then this is the musical instrument that are represented in the museum. So then we move on to Goa Archaeological Museum. So Archaeological Museum at Vela Goa or Old Goa is situated on the convent adjacent to Church of St. Francis of Assisi in Old Goa. It was taken over by the Archaeological Survey of India in 1964 and recognized in reorganized in 1981-82. The museum houses 725 objects in total, out of which 177 are paintings, marking the largest collection of Portuguese paintings which even the Portuguese museums do not have. The painting gallery is referred to as Viceroy Gallery in Portugal. So this collection is basically from the first three galleries that I have mentioned. One of them was the Viceroy Gallery. So these paintings are basically from that gallery. So the collection of the museum consists of granite sculptures, hero stones, and study stones of the early and late medieval period, portraits of governors and viceroys, coins and currency, revenue, court fee stamps, wooden and bronze sculptures, and armory of the Portuguese period. So there are total 7 galleries on the entrance. So on the entrance of the museum, the 3.10 meter high bronze statue of Afonso de Albuquerque, which was earlier at Miramar Circle, greets the visitor. He was the governor general and captain of the seas of India, who was responsible in conquering Old Goa in 1510 CE. The key gallery, or gallery number 1, serves as an introduction to the nature of exhibits in the museum. Some of the landmark exhibits in this gallery are Standing Vishnu of the 13th century, with the Prabhavari carved in Dashavatar, the 10 incarnations of Vishnu, 2 damaged Uma Maheshwar sculptures, Mahishasur Mardini, Gajalakshmi, and Standing Surya. All these sculptures belong to the Kadamba period of 12th to 13th century. So next please. The main attraction of this gallery is the imposing 3.6 meter high bronze statue of Luis Vaz de Camões, the national poet of Portugal. He holds in his hand a scroll of poems, the Lusíadas, which elogizes the Vasco da Gama, who succeeded in finding sea route from Europe to India. This sculpture was bombarded post-liberation of Goa and was taken, it was broken into 3 pieces, which was later conserved and put up here. Other objects of this gallery are royal coat of arms. So among the royal coat of arms, and there we also have bishop coat of arms. So royal coat of arms was given to the people in honor of their armory or the on field that be bravery that they show, and the bishop coat of arms for the religious people. Then Roman Catholic sacramental emblem, typical Goan fruit baskets carved in stone. So here we can see the Goan locally available fruits as well. The tombstone of Dom Josi Cariatil, Archbishop of Fregnanor in Kerala. The tombstone of Dom Daigo in Orana, the first premier captain of Daman, etc. Also displayed in the large mode of Old Goa with the all protected monuments under ASL. So this is the on the top left hand side, it is from one of the broken temple that they are able to pause here, and on the right hand side on the in front that you see, that is the Padmanabh that we could see that I mentioned, and on the back is the poet. So another important part or attraction of this gallery is the Captain of Georgia relics. So the interesting story goes like, the Georgian queen was very beautiful and the king of Persia fell in love with her and sent a marriage proposal to her. And further, she had to change her religion, but upon her refusal to marry him and change her religion, he killed her into 3 pieces, which was a great kind of devotion towards the country, for the country people. So three monks, what they did, they collected her body parts or relic, and they just went into 3 directions. But upon knowing this, the king killed those 2 monks. But one could sustain the relic and it could reach the Augustine Tower, and he kept them there. So this is very important as from the point of view of the dedication of her towards her country. And So this marks another, this marks the, this gives that object or the relic very much importance. But what is displayed here is not the original relic, it is the copy that they have made. So what is more interesting about, so this is like the more interesting story about the museum objects, that they have very unique stories attached to them, which make them very much important part of the collection. So then we have Veta sculptures of the collection. They are very important. Veta or Veta, it is called a folk deity and enjoys the position of Gram Veta in the coastal region. The well-known historian of Goa, Dr. D.D. Kosambi, described Veta as prince of ghosts and also a god. According to V.R. Mitugoti, rising Kapalikas and Pashupatas who delivered in tantric practices gave favorable conditions for the evolution of Veta sculptures. Veta is considered as the king of spirits and not the evil deity. Veta is considered most affiliated deity by, sorry, deity of Parshuram. So, museum also has very, not very large, but very unique collection of Veta sculptures. So, next slide, please. So, gallery 2, 3, 4, 5, all those galleries house stone sculptures such as types of shikaras. So, in one panel, they have all types of shikaras showcased, believed to have been brought from the ruin of the temple of ancient Saptakoteshwar temple on the Diwar Island. So, the three images of Veta displayed in this gallery represent unique cult of Bhuta Aradhana, the worship of the Bhutas or Vetas, who are demigods residing in the underworld. This cult is prevalent especially in the Malabar, the western coastal region of India. Hindu gods and goddesses like Ganesh, Mahishasurmardini, Vishnu with Garuda, Uma Maheshwar with Kartikeya Bringi, Ganesh, Kala Bhairav, Lakshmi, etc. are also displayed in this gallery. Arabic and Persian sculptures of Adil Shah of Bijapur and Marathi inscriptions of 16th to 17th century, basically the Vedas, are displayed here. Gallery 6 and 7 houses portraits and paintings of the Portuguese government and viceroys of Goa, originally from residential mansions and old secretarial building at Old Goa. Sorry, not Old Goa, Panji. They are shifted to the museum in 1962. A complete list of them can be seen on the wall of the above wooden staircase. The screen showcase displays Portuguese currency and the indigenous Perde, Tanga, Zarafin, Rupiah, etc. So, in another gallery 7, along with huge portrait paintings, wooden sculptures of Christian saints, religious paintings like Martyrdom of Jesus Christ are displayed. A model of court of view is also displayed. So another gallery, so there is one more gallery dedicated to navigation. So navigation gallery displays a wooden model of 16th century Portuguese ship. And iron and stone anchors highlighted the marine importance of Goa since time immemorial. So this is about the Goa Archaeological Museum. Then we move on to another museum in the same location, that is the Museum of Christian Art. Next slide, yes. So the Museum of Christian Art, or called as MoCA, is located in the picturesque holy hill of Old Goa, the 17th century convent of Santa Monica. The first of its kind in Asia, MoCA was set up in collaboration with Carlos Gulbenkian Foundation, Portugal, and Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage in Tech, New Delhi. So this museum was earlier set up at Rashor, then shifted to the current location. So an important part of this collection we have to see. So basically this museum is dedicated to the objects of religious importance to the Christian faith. And they have very beautifully wound story of Virgin Mother Mary. So right from her childhood to the crucifixion of Jesus, the story of Virgin Mother Mary is being wooed, or like it's very beautiful. So that they are we are wooed into the object. So then we have important parts of the collection. Then the infant Jesus, Savior of the world. So this is painted silver statue of the infant Jesus as Savior of the world, shows him with the customary right hand raised in blessing and the left holding the terrestrial orb bearing a cross. While the infant displays European attributes, the babe reveals another hand at work whose influences are Indian. So the work of two different artists, the statue is nonetheless the harmonious blend of Indo-Portuguese elements. While it is usual to say, show the infant Jesus unclothed, here he wears a splendid gold embroidered velvet gown, the thread work of the Mughal Zardozi variety, with its tree of life, vegetal, floral motifs, perhaps Bethany in imprint or origins. Then we have tabernacle monstrance, a spectacular example of Portuguese art. This tabernacle monstrance is made of seemingly dissonant ideas that yet come to make an astonishingly beautiful whole. So at over 4.5 feet in height, it is easy to imagine a dramatic inside affair during the Eucharistic celebration. The symbolic use of animals dates to Ezekiel in the Old Testament. So here, then you can see a round ball or globe sort of at the base, and there is a eagle on the top of it, and the mother eagle cuts off her breast to feed her younger one. So here, the eagle is the representation of Jesus who cuts or suffers for himself to make his kids happy. So then, so next slide, please. So then we have infant Jesus, the Good Shepherd. So images of infant Jesus and the Good Shepherd were popular in Indo-Portuguese art in their composite nature, making them richly suggestive. In the Indian context, it is not difficult to see artists of 17th century instinctively choosing to align Christ's child with one very similar and familiar to him, that of the god Krishna as a boy. Apart from their similar sounding names, the pastoral landscape is significant to both. One is shepherd and the other is a cowherd. So then we have chalice and paten. The chalice is a sacred vessel in the celebration of Mass. It holds the wine and water that is transformed into the blood and Christ as part of Eucharistic celebration. Given their ritual importance, chalices are often made of precious metals and ornate in design. So use of materials to make the object also suggests the prosperity of that period here. So then we have reliquary copper. The cult of relics involving veneration of saints was widespread in the Catholic world, especially in during the Counter-Reformation following the Council of Trent, where it was much emphasized reliquary copper from this period bound. And they're often placed in the niches of the altar vestibule. As the coffers reveal, it is often in the silver work for which the Indian silversmith was justly famed at European, especially Portuguese court, that Indo-Portuguese art finds its high point. The coffers were modeled on leather-covered wooden caskets, very common in Portuguese houses for storing money, jewels, documents, and other items of value. Herein, as the fitting relic, as one of these pair shows, they were clad in scarlet-colored scarlet velvet, perhaps recall price, fashion and sacrifice. So then we have cruets. Cruets are holders for the wine and water used during the mass. They have a domestic aspect, being waved the household items with water and wine. Then we have Holy Trinity. This is imposing marble oratory decoration depicting the Holy Trinity from the chapel of Santa Monica Convent Cloisters. It is justifiably one of the museum's highest highlights. Intricately carved in high relief and lavishly decorated, it reveals mannerisms of late Renaissance as well as Baroque elements. So here, yes, this is the image slide. So here, we can see the Jesus with the ball in his hand and one hand raised to bless on the left hand side. Then on the in the middle, we are shifting from left to right, okay, from the top row. So then we have the mother pelican feeding her younger one. Then we have the Krishna, the Christ shown as the Krishna form, the what do you say, Indo-Portuguese art form. Then we have creates here. Then we have the copper, both in the silver. The down one is velvet and the upper one is not velvet, it's leather, I think. Yes, it's leather. Then the white and the silver that we have, they're the creates. Okay? So this is about the Museum of Christian Art. So then we move on to Pilar Seminary Museum. So before we talk about Pilar Museum, we have to understand the strategic importance of Pilar as a location. So Pilar location is very close by to the Gopakapatna, and Gopakapatna has served as the capital of Goa once upon a time. And there were, when they were like unearthing the Pilar Hillock, they found n number of artifacts there. So they decided to set a museum here of the objects that are found in and around the location. The Pilar Museum is located on the hillock where Pilar Seminary is also located. The museum was found by Father Cosme Fosca and highlights various finds on and around the Pilar Hillock, and now they are preserved in the Seminary Museum. So the Pilar area is strategically important from a historical point of view. One of the ancient capitals of Goa, known as Goa Puri or the Gopakapatna, was centered on the hillock of Pilar. Pilar is presently a hub of educational activities, and Pilar Seminary being the important theological college among them. So the Pilar Museum artifacts have found around Pilar belonging to all religions, Hindu, Buddhist, Jain, and Christians and Muslims. So this shows the diversity of the location itself. So now talking about their collection, the artifacts vary from megalithic tools, Harappan terracotta pieces. So these were taken, borrowed from outside. The father was received them as a donation. So there are very less of them, but major collection is belongs to the that were honored around the area. Then medieval pottery, Satvana pottery, pottery with mica contains sculptures of Vishnu, Buddha, Linga, and temple stones. Birgar medical practitioner balls, coins of British India Company, Nepal, Indian King, Indo-Portuguese, Japanese, Independent India. So all these coins from all the strata they have in their collection. So a cave-like structure in Pilar with a granite sculpture depicting Saint Mary Magdalene is a typical illustration of Pilar tradition of communal harmony. This actually the sculpture is now housed in the museum. I'll show it in the next slide. So according to the legend of Saint Mary Magdalene, did a great penance in the cave in the last days of her life. So can I just move on to the image slide? Yes. Okay. So according to this sculpture shows her figure flat on a ground with symbols of penance and meditation around her. So the sword, forage is a skull, a gospel book and a cross surrounded by crown of thorns. Curiously enough, the sculpture also has a symbol of other religions than prevalent in Goa. The linga signifies the great penance of rishis or bhagwan. The bodhi tree at her feet reminds one of the Buddhist tradition, and the clouds above her is seen an angel with bread and water in her hands. So now we move on to the next slide. Yes, another important part of this collection is the cross with Pallavi inscription found at Agasai or the Akshay village in Goa, confirms the traces of Christianity in Goa before Portuguese conquest of 1510. Okay, so among the interesting artifacts in the museum, of they are all found of the Pillar area, is seal of the Kadambas, sculpture of Jaikeshi I, Shivchitta Paramadideva and his queen Kamala Devi, a Roman amphora, various ancient coins which include two Roman coins and a unique Kadamba gold coin, an 8th century idol of Ganesha, a silver gem box dating back to Kadamba time, the Kisti Puran, handwritten Marathi translation of the Bible from 1609, various paintings of Portuguese times, etc. So this is the only copy of this Quran they have, handwritten copy. So the museum has immense collection of coins across the world. It's very, very beautiful and marvelous collection that they have. They have it across the world. And they belong to, and some of their collection also are belonging to Goan dynasty. Then those were unearthed during the Pillar tank excavation. So here we on the top left hand side that we can see the bowl sort of made of stone. It's a medical practitioner bowl. It's a very huge one. It seems very small in the image here, but it's a very huge bowl. So what we know about wars, what we remember about wars is the victory and the loss. But in the victory as well in the loss, there are n number of people who are wounded and who need medical medication. So these are the testaments of those memories. And then on the right hand side, we have the temple stones or the temple pillar stones of the nearby temple. Then we have Krishna Puran copy here. And then on the other left hand, right hand side at the corner, it's a yoni. Okay. So it's a part of worship. So basically it marks the importance or the presence of Shakti cult at the site or the pillar below. Next slide, please. So now we move on to Indian Customs and Central Excise Museum. So the Indian Customs and Central Excise Museum is the first of its kind depicting the rich history of Indian Customs and Central Excise Department. It was inaugurated and thrown open by the then Union Finance Minister Pranab Mukherjee on July 25, 2009. The museum building is said to have been built in. So, can you just move on to the next slide? The building slide? Yes. So, the blue building that you see is said to be 1600 years old, built somewhere around 421 years old, and it is in the heart of the Panji city, just near the Mandavi Dam. So, the two storied building has wooden flooring and wide staircase built in Portuguese style. So next one, yes. So right now we will just move on with the collection of the museum. So the museum collection houses an array of fields, antiquities, customs, heritage, and it tells the exciting story of India's smuggling history, displays the unusual items of uncovered by keen-eyed customs officials and the elaborate plans of the smugglers went to the end in an effort to conceal their activities. The Indian Customs and Central Excise Museum has been conceptualized to depict the never-ending battle between the smugglers or the tax evaders and the men on duty. The various features are in the original, such as arms, armor, bronze images, stone sculptures, etc., along with several shields and gold beads. The museum, through its collection, is of rare and unique items on display. Traces the evolution of this theme from the days of Indus Valley civilization till the present time. It takes forward the same theme through artifacts, documents, and manuscripts, photographs, etc., to give an aura of the continuous action and counteraction. The first National Museum of Customs and Central Excise reflects the mood of the nation, which has depicted the ancient civilization. It is not only this speaks of the articles and objects, but it has identity, its identity, and speaks of the past. It's hoped that the museum would take various viewers more than 2,005 years back, moving the history of the Indian civilization. So the museum galleries are, the museum collection is divided into 9 galleries. So introduction of the custom, introduction to the gallery provides information about the setup of the Central Board of Customs and Indirect Taxes, its organization and its contribution to the revenue to the nation. So basically getting known to the Indian Customs section. Then we have a Customs Heritage Gallery, which enlightens the about the Arthashastra of Kautilya, the ancient trade ports, relaxation, taxation parts, seals and sealing, semi-precious stones and gold beads, which indicate its trade and commerce with West and Central and Gulf countries. Then we have Arms and Ammunition Gallery, and we have Battle of Gifts Gallery, and we have Feature Gallery. Then there is Central Excise Gallery, which has display of connected displays. Then we have display of salt heads built by the British along the country to collect the salt tax and to prevent the smuggling of the salt. Then Central Excise Gallery 2, there are 2 galleries of the Central Excise, displays commodities, items like cotton, yarn, thread, which Central Excise duty was first imposed by the British government. Then we have Necrotic Gallery, which provides information on opium and the revenue control in India. Then we have International Customs Gallery. Displays the uniform of customs personnel of different countries. It provides information of the World Customs Organization. Then we have Chemical Laboratory, displays instruments used by the customs officials for testing and analyzing and the sports gallery trophies, shields, medals won by the customs and central excise team for individuals in various fields of sports and achievements of revenue targets. So now we move on to Goa Chitra Museum. So Goa Chitra Museum is an ethnographic museum based in Goa, coastal village of Barnavli in Salsa Taluka of Goa. It has large collection over 4,000 objects or artifacts focusing on Goan traditional agrarian technology and lifestyle. So Goa Chitra is a tribute to Goan society by its founder Victor Hugo Goan to his ancestors and their way of lifestyle using old tradition with them passed to the generation. So Victor Goan, he founded a museum on a way to protect Goa's tradition as population started shifting to more modern utensils, agrarian techniques with the advancement in technology. So next slide for you. So the museum has started with 200 objects initially. Now they have reached up to 4,000 objects. And the very essence of the collection that I came to know while having interaction with Victor, it was like, I never collect objects just because they are of so and they belong to so and so thing. So he was like, he looks up for the what is the importance of the object, how it is, how he can connect it to the Goan society. And along with that object, there are various other things that are connected to that object. He also focuses on collecting them again. So in this museum, we can see in later on that for he has, so the museum collection is basically divided into three parts. So basically they have the Goa Chakra Museum, then they have Kruti Museum, and then they have Goa Chitra Museum. So in Goa Chakra, they have the chakra is basically the wheel, the transport, and the entire collection is dedicated to the transport, modes of transport. Then there could be human mode of transport, animal mode of transport, the palanquins, then the kids walking instruments, then kids vehicles, then lamps, camels, the stands that they use to climb on the camel. All these things are there. So it's a unique, the reutilization and recycling of materials like wood, doors, windows, pillars, railings, and other materials and elements from over 300 demolished traditional houses that have been recovered by the designer contribute to the contemporary outlook of the structure is blend in traditional and elements modern technology. And that is a very like essence of this museum is he has not displayed the objects in any of the cases or anything. They are like fixed and they are set up in their traditional manner. And that gives them their usability, the essence and the environmental backdrop of the objects. So the information of these objects include, so the whatever the information about the object has been provided was like done through the interviews with the elders, how their usability and all those things. And one of the main vision of the founder of the museum is to make the museum objects handed to the children so they understand its utility. So while talking about Goa Chakra Museum, the various modes of transport are being displayed here. It was opened in 2014. And then we have symbolizing more than just cars, carriages. This museum celebrates wisdom of their ancestors, their creativity and an eye for detail and their love for beauty and art. The collection has special relevance for a country which bears the very center of national flag, Ashok Chakra, the wheel of the law of dharma or virtue, the satya or the truth, was conceived as the guiding principle for those who pledge allegiance to the flag. So exhibition gallery displays a unique collection of 68 non-merchandise indigenous carriages and cars. It is one of a kind of ancient model of Indian transport dating from turn of the 20th century. The collection includes handicrafts and carts drawn by block horses, donkeys, mules, camels, and even humans, besides palanquins from across the country. So now we move on to the next slide. So this is the, like, in short, I can show you their collection. So on the left top hand side, that's a wheel that is used to draw water for the river. The wheel that we set up for a river, so that is the wheel that they have set here. Then on the right hand side, that those are the lamps that could be that were used during for the transportation part. Then on the down left right hand side is the cart that we can see. And on the left hand side, we can see a gola car. So the boxes that you could see are to store the gola, like keep the golas, and the box, it has an opening to store the gola. The next slide, yes, Goa Kruti Museum slide. So the Goa Kruti Museum showcases colonial past of Goa. The museum was shown open for the public from 23rd Jan 2016. The collection of the artifacts depicts colonial influences of Goa. The collection of Goa Kriti is precise and definite and dates back to the 16th century influences where travelers traveled to Goa to work and live. And Goans only traveled abroad, created a new identity of the culture, which still retaining the ethos of the land. A section of Goa Kruti displays colonial furniture which ranged from the simple patterns of the low middle class to the exotic design of the upper middle class aristocracy, supported by the furniture of the display of the crockery cutlery from 18th to 19th century, giving Goa Kruti a feeling of living museum. Ceramics, glassware, silverware, brassware, and a variety of household goods are on display here. The museum highlights include blue and white crockery, etc. So next slide, yes. So this is the image or the like representation that they have kept. As soon as you enter the Goa Kruti Museum, which is a setup you see, it's very much colonial, as you can see. So then we move on to Goa Chitra Museum. So this section totally celebrates the Goan local lifestyle before there were modern technologies to come here. So there are also artifacts of a religious importance to Hinduism and Christianity. And then the range of objects that we have here include kerosene-fired refrigerator, iron pan, oven lamps, petromaxis, nail-less ghano, or the wooden machine. We will see it in later detail. So that extracts oil and sugarcane juice for jaggery. Then traditional games such as tabla, then floss, the spike roller to soften the soil after the ploughing and sowing before sowing, the seed drill machine, then wash basin, rice, bihas, and many more than the experience of traditional Goa. So here I would like to show you some images. So on the left top side, you can see the setup where you have one pot, then there is some square or rectangle sort of structure. So that is the setup basically for the making of peeni, the liquor that they make out of the keju juice. So that is the setup is basically for that. So you can see how they have just tried to give the objects their natural look. Then on the left hand top side, we can see a loom. The loom is not from Goa. It's from somewhere nearby village or nearby state. And then on the down left hand side, right hand side only, we can see many baskets here. Okay, so these include like storing, then we have the laundry bag, then we have bottles, then we have trainers. There are a lot of daily usability objects. Then on the left hand side, you can see it's basically dedicated to the fishing community. So you can see a boat, then you can see a net there. Then on top, all those are used to catch the fish. So the cylindrical sort of that I can see that are used to basically catch the crabs. So next slide please. So the larger vessel that you see here, so the larger vessel that you can see, it was used to make jaggery, and at its backdrop you can see a large wooden structure sort of. So that was basically to get the sugarcane juice out of the sugarcane, and it was the bull was tied to that, and the bull would go in circular motion. Then in the next slide, yes. So here you can see a similar sort of thing that is but this is for the oil extraction out of coconut. since Goa is blessed with coconut cultivation, and there is a lot of coconut that is available, and hence people prefer getting their own coconut oil out of it. So this is the traditional coconut oil making ghano, or the machine, wooden machine that we can say. Yes. And then we move on to their very important activities. So very important part of this museum, what they try to do is, they have a harvest festival where people from all strata of the society, no matter how qualified or what they are, they just come. They have a traditional farm there, the museum, and then they using the museum objects, they practice the farming. So it is like you are experiencing the entire museum experience. And then they have Christmas Eve, so basically it's very much family oriented sort of thing. So they try to make a tree, then they go for the traditional food making thing out of this activity. So next slide. Yes. So now we move on to the Indian Naval Aviation Museum. So the Naval Aviation Museum of Goa showcases the rich history of Indian Naval Aviation. It has a prized collection of vintage and serving aircraft, their engines, armaments, much more to delight and aviation enthusiasts or just a curious tourist. A day museum must be for the old museum. The aviation or arm of the Indian Navy had almost beginning, modest beginning with the induction of Todd Sealand aircraft in the year 1953 with 10 amphibian Sealand aircraft. As the number of type of the aircraft grew and some got phased out of the service, a need was felt to preserve the history and legacy of the and trace the growth of the naval and aviation, and hence this museum was set up. First of its kind in Asia, basically. The museum was inaugurated on 12th October 1988 by Admiral R.H. Sahilani, the first naval pilot to land a air fighter aircraft, Hawker Seahawk, on the deck of the aircraft carrier. So the museum basically initially had a small collection of six aircraft of World War II vintage, Sealand, Ellis. These are the names of the aircraft. Today, there are 15 types of aircraft at the museum and wide-ranging exhibits, including a scaled model of aircraft carrier INS Virat, complete with ski jump runway and sea harrier jump on its deck. The museum also preserves the historic Super Constellation aircraft, which paved way for the Indian Navy to take maritime patrol duties from Indian airports. Next slide. So the interior, so the museum entrance itself is designed in the shape of INS Virat. So it's a warrior ship and has a number of interesting galleries displaying the naval equipment, predominant battles, a simulation room, and existing granite slug paying tribute to the brave souls who gave their lives in the service of their country. The interior galleries of the museum are accessed through a ship hatch and the design to look interior of the INS Virat, the naval aircraft. And the two main galleries of this museum are Virat Gallery and Vikrant Gallery. So the Virat Gallery is on the down floor and the top floor is the Vikrant Gallery. Both galleries boast wooden models of the ships that are named for. So one of the first room displays collection of the arms and armaments, including bombs, torpedoes, rockets, warheads, the depth charges, etc. The Sonoboy room has a collection of Sonoboys, which are sensors that are used by aircraft for detection of water and enemy targets. The Suraksha room has various gears and gadgets used for protection while at sea in the air, including floating dinghy, parachute, ejector seat, pilots, overall, etc. The next slide. Yes. So one of the museum walls is adorned with granite slabs for Shradhanjali, which has inscribed in the name of all those who have given their lives in the service of their country. So there are, these are the naval pilots from year 1958 to 1997. Adjacent to this plaque is the meditation room, which is part of the museum, decorated with cool granite and graceful art. The room exudes peace and serenity. The museum also houses gallery commemorates all major naval battles and that have taken place since formation of the Indian Navy. The freedom struggle, all the Goa, notably the Operation Vijay, that has played a very pioneering role in the freedom struggle of Goa, is depicted by a stunning series of black and white photographs. So the museum displays number of aircraft that were used by the Indian Navy throughout its history. These are displayed outside the museum open air gallery with both planes and the helicopters, as well as display of aircraft and parts. So this is the just the so on the left top hand side, you can see a red ring sort of. Yes, so that is basically the door is made of the that looks like an entrance to the IMS Viraj. Then we have the ship itself here that you can see. Then on the down, you see it's a detector. Then okay. So now we move on to the houses of Museum of Goa. Houses of Goa Museum. So the houses of Goa Museum is tucked away in the ceramic locality of Torda, Salvador da Mundo, North Goa. It's in North Goa, founded and developed by famous architect Gerard da Cunha. The museum showcases a historical overview of material and built culture that came about as a result of the region's encounter with the Portuguese. Goan architecture is unique because of this beautiful amalgamation of Portuguese influences, local aesthetics, and indigenous buildings. So the architectural story unfolds across the levels of charming shape-like buildings. So can you just move on to the next slide? Yes. So you can see the shape of the museum. It's in the shape of a boat. So the first level depicts Goa in context of the world, followed by the display of wide range of designs found within Goan architecture. The second floor delves into the details of Goan architecture, the doors, windows, railings, construction material, furniture. The uppermost level of the museum showcases the final amalgamation of the Goan Portuguese style. Next slide, yes, Moda Goa style. Yes. So now we are moving on to another museum that is yet to come up. They are opening somewhere in October 2021. So the museum is the brainchild of renowned fashion designer late Mr. Wendell Roderick. Moda Goa Museum is based in Kolwade village of Bhartiya Taluka of Goa. The museum building itself is the restored 450 years old ancestral home of Wendell Roderick, named Casa Dona Maria in the village of Kolwade. And it is now named as Moda Goa Museum and Research Center, a museum dedicated to Goan costume, the first of its kind in the country and possibly the only in the world. So, and by referring to Wendell Roderick's interviews, so in one of his interviews, he mentioned how the idea or the concept of looking or like forming a museum dedicated to costume was conceived. So the idea lies where cartoonist Mario Miranda suggested him to do a research on a garment called Sonno Baju, a traditional bone wrap around the garment, somewhat like sarong and bone or under the a blouse. So while researching on this object, he realized that there are many things that the world needs to know about the costume history. So that is how the concept was developed. So now talking about the building. So Vinder Rogers moved into the Casa Donna Maria in 1993 after the Bombay riots. It was home that all they lived for 25 years. They hosted many interesting intellectual celebrities at Casa Donna Maria. So it was used for many models, photographers of all the promotion parts. So the home, so this is about the room that they had. So after phase two of the completion of the museum, they will have some more like rooms up for the conference room and the storage areas and all this. So the about the collection, the museum has very good collection of the costumes and the other things that they wear along the costumes. So important part or the important attraction for Vinder Rogers was the personal collection of the curios, artifacts over the years. So now he focused on two objects that were important to him. That autograph from Pope and the Dalai Lama are precious part of the collection. That is what he has mentioned in his interview. So now we move on to the Goa Museum of Goa. So Museum of Goa is a private contemporary art space founded by Dr. Subodh Kerkar in 2015. The museum celebrates Goa's history and people through the contemporary art. MOG is envisioned not just a repository of objects, but as a laboratory of ideas where all forms of art in constant dialogue with each other. Histories of Goa, a permanent exhibition at the museum, offers a glimpse to the multiple histories of the state, highlights lesser known stories of the storied past. The exhibition showcases contemporary artists from Goa as well as artworks inspired by the state. So, and MOG also hosts temporary exhibitions all year round, showcasing the best talent from Goa and around the world. Exhibition at MOG are desperate Indian, medium and diverse Indian activities. So around, I'm talking about their activities, they are very active in conducting the educational activities, basically, educational and interactive activities. So they organize workshops, art for kids, lectures, musical performances, residences for budding artists. Their weekly series called as Emoji Sundays, Emoji means mood. Movies love in Tamil language, host eminent artists. So scholars and activists who speak on subjects close to their heart. So then we move on to the another museum, that is St. Thomas Museum. It's in Salsa Taluka of Goa. So it's a private collection of Thomas Antony da Costa situated in Varka village. The museum focuses on technological revolution that has been experienced. So, for the typewriters, they have from typewriter to the modern technology. Then the museum has the mechanical calculators, typewriters, yes, the cameras, timekeepers, postal weights, which are professionally used, clocks and watches. The highlight of this collection is a grand piano. So they have a very grand piano that is still in working condition, and that is the piano is considered as the only working oldest piano in Asia with ivory keys. Okay. Yes. So that we are done with the museums of Goa. So like I have a very personal opinion to share as well. So while we go to the museum, we always have to look beyond the objects and the space that they are placed in, because museum is the only place where you can analyze what has been said You can literally read the labels, you can literally read the things, and you can just connect them to your life, them to you yourself, and you can know a lot of things about their particular area, the particular region. And because you have the objects at your eyesight, it is very much transparent thought or the opinion that you can build. That's it. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to present my presentation to you. Over to Vijay sir.
थैंक यू थैंक यू थैंक्स अ लॉट. जैसा हमने कहा था कि ये संग्रहालय जो है ये हमारे उस राज्य की विरासत होता है और वहाँ पर हम उस राज्य की संस्कृति वहाँ की कला और विरासत जो है उसे अच्छी तरह से देख सकते हैं. ये आपने बहुत अच्छे तरीके से बताया और स्पेशली गोवा म्यूजियम ऑफ गोवा या इस तरह के जो संग्रहालय है तो गोवा की माने लगभग 2500 साल पहले की जो संस्कृति से लेकर आज की आधुनिक संस्कृति तक का एक बहुत अच्छा सफर रहा. इसके लिए आपका बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया. आपने बहुत ही अच्छा मार्गदर्शन हमें किया. फिर इसी तरह से हम इस विषय पर जो है मिलते रहेंगे और हम सब मिलकर के इसी तरह इसी संग्रहालय की विरासत या हमारे कला और स्थापत्य की विरासत जो है इसके बारे में समझने का निरंतर प्रयास करते रहेंगे. अंजलि मापारी जी आपका फिर से एक बार मैं शुक्रिया अदा करता हूँ और यहाँ पर आज का सेशन जो है हम रोकते हैं. थैंक यू थैंक्स अ लॉट.
थैंक यू सो मच.
थैंक यू.